Okay, I think we'll go ahead and get going. My name is Andrew Wilder. I'm Vice President here at the USIP for the Center for South and Central Asia, and our privilege to welcome all of you today to this event. I just returned on Sunday from about 10 days in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. I was there with Scott Smith, and we had planned this event to try to give some feedback on some of our impressions from the visit. But the visit had other purposes too. We were visiting our team, both in Islamabad and Kabul, where we're running programs, wide range of programs. In fact, we're fortunate to have one of my colleagues, Casey Johnson, who just got off the plane this morning, who oversees a lot of our work in our Kabul program, especially in areas relating to countering violent extremism. We're also at USIP supporting a lot of research, and I would encourage all of you interested in Afghanistan to go to our website and check out some of our publications relating to Afghanistan and Pakistan and the broader South Central Asia region. In particular, just wanted to highlight a couple papers, and some of them are outside and back. You can help yourself to those or download them. My colleague Bill Bird recently published one on Afghanistan's continuing fiscal crisis, no end in sight, and we're going to have some more time to talk about that today because, again, just coming back, that was one of the things that really struck me is the very dire state of the economy and the political implications of that. We also published a very interesting paper by Dede Dirksen on the politics of disarmament and rearmament in Afghanistan, which I think is particularly topical because it focuses in quite depth, great detail in terms of the political dynamics in Kunduz province, and that's been, as many of you know, very problematic of late, and many of the dynamics that are playing out now she deals with in that paper. One of the things at USIP we try hard to do is a lot of our programs are basically intended to be mini research projects, and over the years we've done lots of research on the informal justice sector in Afghanistan, among other things. And one of the key issues there is how land disputes are resolved. Land is probably the number one driver of conflict in Afghanistan. And so we just published a paper by Erica Gaston and Lillian Dang, another both of who used to work in Kabul, Lillian still does, on addressing land conflict in Afghanistan. And then last but not least, I think an important paper by Sean Kane on talking with the Taliban, should the Constitution be a point of negotiation? Sean used to be a former colleague here, then served in Afghanistan for the past couple of years with UNAMA. In addition to our work with visiting the program team, however, we did, Scott and I had the opportunity with our country director, Shah Mahmood Miakil, to do the rounds of many officials, civil society leaders, U.S. and other international officials, and many former Afghan government officials as well. I would not describe the mood as upbeat in Kabul, unfortunately. I was hoping we could have some. We're going to struggle to find a few positive things to say in our presentations, but I think the mood was very down in Kabul on a range of topics, which we'll go into today. But basically, a sense of political paralysis amongst the team, the National Unity Government team, or not a team, a sense of economic collapse, which I alluded to, a deteriorating security situation, and a perception of fading, rapidly fading international attention and U.S. attention in particular. And combined, I think that's creating quite a toxic and destabilizing mix. Very specifically on the security situation, with Dr. Ali Jalali, we'll be speaking on in more detail. I think the statistics now show that in the first 5 months of this year, more ANSF and some of the associated militias like the ALP have died than total number of U.S. troops in Afghanistan since 2001. So casualty rates are extremely high and worrying. I spoke to one senior government official who had just returned from Rozgan province, and he was quite worried there just by the exhaustion of the ANSF, attrition rates, and with that level of casualty rates, increasingly difficulties in terms of recruitment. But still fighting hard to try with the objective of really trying to hold on to the districts of Afghanistan and to get through this fighting season. and demonstrate that the ANSF can stand without the large levels of international troops and assistance it was receiving before. But in lots of our meetings, many requests, again, for reconsideration of the pace at which the international support is drawing down, and in particular military support, close air support in particular, and then areas around the ISR, the intelligence surveillance and reconnaissance support that we were providing. Some talk about Daesh. I'll let, again, Dr. Jalali speak a bit more to that. My own personal view, and from what I was talking to there, it struck me as it's very different than what ISIS is in other contexts, but much more reflecting the fragmentation of power that's taking place as the central government is perceived to be growing weaker. Local actors are becoming stronger, and this includes actors like the governor of Balkh province or the chief of police in Kandahar or some of the local militia leaders, but also organized crime elements, disgruntled Taliban elements, but also some of the people who've been pushed from Pakistan into Afghanistan due to the offensive in North Waziristan, and I think quite opportunistically are using the Daesh label in Afghanistan. Politically, I think we got a sense of, again, things aren't going terribly well. That said, in the last couple weeks, a sense that there have been small uptick, and I think due to the appointments finally taking place, pretty much a close full cabinet now in place with just the defense minister needing approval. And so a sense that things are moving, a Supreme Court justice is appointed, including Anissa Rasooli, a woman, which I believe will be the first time we'll have a female justice on the Supreme Court in Afghanistan. So a lot of the appointments, including the final roster of governor appointments, I think will be made during the coming week. So that gave a little sense of that things were moving, but overall, though, a sense of paralysis, that things weren't moving quickly enough, lots of questions around the president's management style and how relations with Dr. Abdullah and his team. I think when we left from Washington, there's lots of talk about the dysfunctionality between the two teams. I think in Kabul, what struck me a bit more was some of the dysfunctionality within the teams, and I think that might even be a more serious problem than even between the two teams. But questions around Parliament, the Loya Jirga, the elections, of course, and my colleague Scott Smith will talk in more detail about those issues. Again, the economy I touched on, I think very serious situation. I think one very tangible demonstration about this, or if I can give an anecdote, was that Scott and I tended to arrive early at most of our meetings in Kabul for a change because the traffic was much less than usual. So, but there's just a sense that little is happening on the economic front, very little investment. And ironically, even some of the real, attention that President Ghani's government has given to the anti-corruption agenda and the scrutinizing of contracts, I think in some ways has also scared off some investors because before they probably knew with quite some confidence that they could pay off these three senior officials and get a contract, whereas now there's a lot more uncertainty in terms of how it works and whether the president will scrutinize a contract and be unhappy with it and reject it. But overall, just very little happening on the economic front. But Bill Byrd will go into great more detail on that. And then last but not least, I also was in Pakistan before and then to Kabul, and lots of questions about President Ghani's the major bold political measure he took in terms of reaching out to Pakistan, which in Pakistan was being very, very favorably received. Unfortunately, I got the sense that President Ghani was in some ways more popular in Pakistan than in Kabul, precisely because of this outreach to Pakistan, which was not going down well, and there was lots of skepticism. So a really important question there, I think, in terms of why President Ghani took such a risk and the expectations of something in return, which I think Muid will be talking more about in his presentation. So I think I'll leave it at that, and with no further ado, I think I've introduced everyone. You can get biographical information on them. I don't want to take time, so I'll turn it over to Dr. Jalali first, who is a senior Afghan expert here at USIP, but also a distinguished professor at NDU and the NISA Center. And he will be talking about the security situation. Dun Scott, political, Bill on the economic, and Muid on the Pakistan and peace process related issues. We'll then open it up for a discussion. So I'm looking forward to that. But thank you, and over to you.
Good morning. Thank you, Andrew. And Andrew set the tone for this part of the presentation of mine, which is on security. Security does not can be established in a vacuum. It relates to other issues of development, governance, economic, and relations of Afghanistan with its neighbors, particularly with Pakistan. But Afghan security forces suffered record casualties this year. At the beginning of last month, the number of Afghan soldiers, policemen, including local police, has increased 70% as compared with the same time last year. It was about nearly 5,000. And that means that the average casualties per week was 330 men, which is a very high compared to the experience of Afghanistan in the past 13 years. Why this happened? Let me focus on four issues here in order to present to you a picture of security. First, what are the drivers of insecurity in Afghanistan this year? And second, how the Afghan forces are reacting to this, and what are the challenges and constraints that the Afghan national security forces have. Second, how the Taliban or insurgents are adapting to the situation and using new approaches, new methods that is somehow different from the past. And four, how one can improve the situation. What and what measures should be taken in order to improve the situation in Afghanistan, at least until the end of this fighting season. The driver of security and insecurity in Afghanistan are quite obvious to all. This year is the first year that the combat mission of the international forces ended. This does not mean only that the numbers of troops, foreign troops, were reduced, but the kind of assistance that international forces were provided to the Afghan national security forces were dwindled and sometimes again to the zero. The most important part of it was the air support, firepower, and also most importantly, ISR, intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets, which were withdrawn from Afghanistan. At the same time, this is a typical fighting season in Afghanistan, but under new conditions, and a new condition which there are no foreign troops fighting. And at the same time, the unity government has its own vulnerabilities and being tested by the insurgents. And finally, the insurgents were trying to get into a very favorable position in case there's a deal which there are talks going on in the region, whether it will happen or not, but they want to get into a favorable conditions. At the same time, the tension inside the government of Afghanistan maintaining the unity of the government which was established on the basis of a deal, and at the same time to govern effectively. Sometimes effectiveness has been sacrificed by maintaining the unity, and that actually been exploited by the insurgents and terrorists. And that means vulnerabilities in the establishing the unity of effort, coordination, and also integration of all instruments of power of the government in order to fight the insurgents. And at the same time, some opportunistic moves by some groups who are claiming to be affiliated with ISIS. You know, ISIS is becoming a major concern in Afghanistan, although one cannot say that ISIS is there in force. But there are opportunities for people who want to use this. I think the most, damaging, situation is in the Nangarhar province, in the areas in the remote districts of the Spinghar province, which actually separates Nangarhar province from Tira, from Kurram Valley. And the districts in these areas, like Nazian, like Durbaba, like Achin, in that the problems that develop first as tribal feuds and develop into personal, vendetta feuds, it's a situation where some of them are using this ISIS impact. Some of them probably are trying or hoping that you will be supported by ISIS. For example, and that this last week in court, one group that they beheaded some people, some Taliban, they actually asked the people either to join them or leave the court area. And thousands of people are leaving court. That was the moot area on the border with Tira. This incident, if they continue, this creates a new problem. It is serious enough to make the Taliban to send a letter this week to Baghdadi, whether he is alive or not, but the Mansour. So it means that they are concerned. This is another issue that some who were disenchanted, some who are against the talks with the government, some who actually lost resources, they would use this opportunity in order to get opportunity and to get to a prominence, and probably will add to that dimension of insecurity in Afghanistan. All these create this complicated situation. How the Afghan national security forces deal with it? They have their own constraints. The most important challenge with the constraint is the low force to space ratio in Afghanistan. You know, if you go to textbooks and in a counterinsurgency, you have a certain number of security men that you have to have, which is very high. In case of Afghanistan, some people give it 600,000. Afghanistan is not will not be able to do that, will not sustain such a force. So therefore, it's overextended. On the other hand, the number that we are talking about, 352 police and army and about 30,000 LAP, but nobody knows how many of these people are really in the field, can be used. Because if you look at the cycle of operation in the army, they are in training, or they are involved in operations, or they are in leave. So therefore, at one time, maybe only 40% or 30% of the troops that we have on the book will be available. Even if you do not count the attrition and the desertion in Afghanistan. So it is the problem of low force to space ratio. And on the other hand, the concern not to lose territory. This has been an obsession, not only today, but also in the past in Afghanistan. There are many districts that will not make any strategic difference in the viability of a government. But still, Afghanistan always wanted to have the control of every district in Afghanistan. And although many districts means only a small security post, that post does not have control over the whole area of a district. But since symbolically, it means that the district's under government control. So now, on the other hand, the notion that in an insurgency, you have to protect the population, you have to have a presence, that caused the national security forces to be deployed overextensively and sitting in small posts and vulnerable to the attack of the enemy. I call it sometimes many thousands of mini Denben force that can be easily taken out. You know, in April, when I was in Kabul, the Chief of General Staff of the Army Academy told me that in Badakhshan, when the situation became very tense and the insurgents attacked posts in Jurm districts in Badakhshan, I asked him, he said, in that area, there's one battalion and one company deployed in three districts, Jurm, Yamagan, and Wardoj. And the headquarters of that is in Kunduz. There's no headquarters of Kunduz, but in Faizabad. So therefore, there's no command and control there. And that battalion company was deployed in 41 security posts across these districts. So it is, these are posts vulnerable to even a small attack by insurgents. And that's why they lost many people at that time. The other issue is the institution incoherence of the security forces, army, police, intelligence. You know, when you go to south in Kandahar or in Helmand or in the core in Jalalabad, you have these troops spread all over this area in small security forces. If you want to launch an offensive operation, you have to mobilize another force from Kabul, usually 111 division. They go there, and they combine, they create a combined force of police and cop, of commandos, of local forces, of other police local forces. And they combine together and they launch the attack. There is no coordination, different cultures, different capacities, different priorities. So that problem actually always are there. And when they launch an operation there, they go there, they kill some people, and then in the media they present you with body counts. Every week they have body counts, but it does not change the situation drastically. On the other hand, the Afghan national security forces suffer from the lack of enablers. I mentioned the Air Force and intelligence assets, logistics. In Badakhshan, one of the reasons that many posts were fell to the Taliban was because the Humvees were out of gasoline. They could not move it. And the soldiers were out of ammunition. The logistics were bad. In terms of intelligence, one intelligence officer told me in Kabul that in the past, last year, they could foil the militant terrorist attacks they could foil 7 out of 10. He said, now we cannot foil more than 3 out of 10 because of this lack of, this gap in the intelligence assets. Consequently, the army is vulnerable. They either sit in security post only to be attacked, or they launch major sweeping operation like one Zulfiqar and south. Taliban has adopted to this. In the face of major operation like Zulfiqar in Helmand, they leave the area, only leave some snipers in the area and AIDs, and otherwise they go underground. They go, they sweep the area. What they do, they cause more damage to the population than that will happen in Helmand. In Helmand, particularly in the Sangin area, one bazaar of 400 was totally burned. Now there is a controversy in Kabul that this was burned by the special forces because they thought this is the enemy. So when they leave, then there is a conflict between police and army. Who should stay behind? The police said, okay, we are a fighting force. You are using us as a fighting force. So we are fighting force, we are not police. And the army said, oh, you are police, now you have to man the area. This kind of argument continues. The other the way that the Taliban handled the situation was quick concentration, attack on target several times simultaneously, and then disperse. This they call hashar. Hashar means, traditionally, hashar means to mobilize people for a common cause, temporarily. So they call it hashar. Hashar is a new terminology in the Taliban letter. And they concentrate the forces, as they did in Kunduz, they did in Badakhshan. And then they try to kill as many as Afghan security forces, give this impression that the Kabul government is collapsing. In the same time, they disperse. And finally, they also in the cities, they increase the suicide attacks in order to generate news and show to the world that the Afghan government is not capable, and also to the Afghan people, the Afghan government is not capable of providing security. Now, I think in order for the Afghan security forces to weather out this fighting season, I think they have to make some adjustments in their operations. First of all, they should pursue the talks, but should not be very excited about it. A kind of a momentum was created in February, in the beginning of this administration of Afghanistan, but it was lost in February, actually. First, because there was so much publication, publicity was made about it, and that, for some of Taliban commanders who were against the constitution to become more violent and not conduct more attacks on Afghan targets. At the same time, the Pakistan probably found it more difficult than they promised to force the Taliban to come to the negotiating table. But I think one can say that there is change in Pakistan. But how this change will translate into reality, into practical action, is not known. The talks in Qatar, in Dubai, and then in Norway, these are all probably they benefit Taliban. Because as far as I know, the Taliban actually had the right to choose the people who come to talk to them. Most of them, they are sympathizers. They come there, and they're a Taliban talking cafe. They take advantage of it. They use it as a PR, but no substantial change. And now in Norway, the government delegation has gone to Norway, but it is not to talk with Taliban. It is to participate in a peace mediation conference in Norway, and they hope that on the side of the conference, they will have an opportunity to talk to them. I don't know. So therefore, don't get excited. It will take time. But at the same time, you have to be ready to change the situation inside Afghanistan in order to change the mentality of people outside Afghanistan. You cannot change the mentality outside by asking them. You have to bring changes inside the country in order to change the calculation outside. And at the same time, in terms of instead of launching major sweeping operations, I think there is a need to kind of a small operation on concentration of the Taliban, distract concentration, go after the targets in a larger sense. You know, I was talking to one commander in Wardak province, a battalion commander, who created a kind of safe area in the Chak district. It was a very insecure district in the past. What he did, that battalion commander, he removed all the security posts. Instead, he spread intelligence cells all over the country. Whenever he found a concentration in the night, they launch a raid against that. He extensively used ambushes, and therefore he took the war to the Taliban rather than react to their attacks. And that secured the Chak province. They went to the areas where they could operate better, mostly to Jagatu, to Daimirdat, and to Saidabad districts in the province. So this is the model that they should do. Instead of sitting in the security posts only to be attacked simultaneously by overwhelming forces, and with no reaction capacity to go and help them. A security force could provide you with two things. Provide you with time and space for reaction. Depending on the size of a security force, this time and space differs. But only if you have the capacity to go and help them. Can get you 2 hours, 3 hours, 1 day, 2 days, but not indefinitely. The culture of security, setting a security force is now in advance, and is to think that that security force is there to provide security with no capacity to go and reinforce them. Yamagan is lost in the Badakhshan because of this. Yamagan is an important district in Badakhshan because that's the area where the mines, the Labs mine are located. And some people, some strong men are fighting over the mines. But now they lost the districts, and now they are mobilizing forces to take it back. It's in the words of General Patton, they are paying twice for the same real estate. So this is something they need to be changed. At the same time, there should be a balance in the dispersion of security forces with the ability to enforce them within the time to avoid their destruction. This is not happening. And many commanders of the security forces complain to me that this is the case. When they are there, they are just on their own. And particularly, logistics is bad. They cannot receive ammunition time and gas on time. Afghanistan has three brigades, special forces brigades, and they are should be the main elements of fighting the Taliban or the insurgents and attack them in raids instead of sweeping operation. I'm running out of time. We can discuss some other issues during the question answer. But also one thing I wanted to talk here, but maybe we'll talk it later, about this idea of arming militias. Is it good or bad in order to make up for the low ratio of space, troop to space ratio? Thank you very much.
Is it good or bad?
Well, you have to look at it case by case.
So I'll put in a plug for the future of the Afghan local police, a recent report by the crisis group. Mark Schneider is here with us today, so I'm sure he'll have views on that during the question and answer period. But also Day-Day Dirksen's paper, which I referred to earlier, on the whole process of the politics of the disarmament and rearmament of militias also tackles that. But we'll now turn it over to Scott Smith. Scott is our director for Afghanistan and Central Asia programs at USIP. Scott first started working in Afghanistan in the mid-1990s with NGOs working in Afghanistan. He then had a long and very distinguished career with the UN, working on Afghanistan for most of the last decade, including as a senior special advisor to the SRSG in Kabul during the very famous 2009 and 10 election. However, I think the 2014 election surpassed it in interest and fame. But anyway, with no further ado, I'll turn it over to Scott, who will talk a bit about the political issues we saw in Afghanistan during our recent visit.
Thanks, Andrew. Since you mentioned those happy days with the UN in 2009, when I was working for Kai Eide, who was a Norwegian SRSG, and he used to go to the Security Council and sort of say, no more doom and gloom. You know, we have to look at the bright side. And unfortunately, I wish I could say that I would be able to cheer you up after Ali's somewhat depressing presentation, but I'm not sure that I'll be able to offer you that guarantee. What I'll try and do is give it in a sort of small doses. As Andrew said, you know, a couple of weeks ago, we were getting ready to go to Afghanistan, and we had been hearing from people, including our own team members who had been there recently, giving a very negative prognostic. And we sort of had the sense that this government of national unity that had been brokered as a result of this difficult election had sort of become a government of institutionalized crisis in some sense. The way we've been analyzing the legitimacy of the Afghan government since 2001 has been sort of according to three parameters. One, especially after 2004, electoral legitimacy. The other one, what Sam Huntington calls performance legitimacy, is it delivering services? Is it getting the allegiance of people because it's meeting their needs? And third, particular to Afghanistan, I think, is the international community behind it? I think that's always been a key issue for leaders. And I think this government is weak on all three dimensions, weaker than the Karzai administration was on all three dimensions, I would say. And the question is, when it's facing the problems that, first of all, on the security side, we've just heard Minister Jalali describe, then unless there's some unexpected good news, the significant economic problems that you're likely to hear from Bill in a little while, you know, how can a government that lacks a sort of legitimacy survive? Can it survive? And what are the real issues in terms of this institutionalized crisis? What are the dynamics behind it? And can it be resolved in any way or improved? So the short answer to the question that we had for ourselves, is this government in a real deep state of crisis, has two parts. The first part is yes. And the second part is, and on top of it, there are some people in Afghanistan, for their own political interests, in a somewhat misguided way, I believe, trying to exaggerate that sense of crisis. And neither of these answers, I think, are particularly good news for Afghanistan. So let me go through the way I sort of understood the dynamics of what's happening inside this government perhaps what we can do to improve its functioning. As Andrew said, the first issue is that the problem is not so much between the two teams, between the President, Ashraf Ghani, and the Chief Executive Officer, Abdullah Abdullah. These are the two candidates who were sort of brought into this power-sharing arrangement after, again, an election that was contested and inconclusive. The first problem is within each team. And what seems to be happening is that each of the principals has been losing support from their allies for different reasons, but with similar consequences. Andrew alluded to the management style of President Ghani, who is seen, at least from what we had heard, not very consultative, very micromanaging. Everybody in Afghanistan has a story about the 500-page report that the president stayed up the night before reading. And it's interesting for everybody, it's a different report, so he's sort of reading multiple 500-page reports every night and commenting on them. And this is not necessarily giving a sense of confidence. One of the telling comments that was made about President Ghani was, he eats lunch alone. And that was sort of, you know, this is a time, I think, that President Karzai used to use to listen to people, hear what's going on, consult, and so forth. So you have this kind of image of a lonely micromanager who lectures to people and has taken all this burden on himself. I think one of the reasons that CEO Abdullah is also losing members of his team is that he hasn't been able, obviously, to accommodate all of them. Backing, when you back a candidate in an election, any election anywhere, there's obviously an expectation among your top backers that you'll get certain positions. When, as a result of the election, you have to split the government in two, by definition, you're going to leave some people unhappy. And unfortunately, there's had to be some fairly powerful people who have been left unhappy. As a result, they've been gravitating towards other centers of political power that I'll describe in a little while. So you both have the sense of that even before you get to the problems between the teams, the leaders don't necessarily have the full confidence of their own teams that they had 7 or 8 months ago or 10 months ago when these governments first came into power, and that can lead to a sort of dissipation of power that, in a second, I'll describe, can be more complicated than it's been in the past, in the Karzai years. Now, then you also have the problems between the two teams. Somebody pointed out that the structure of the National Unity Government encourages the extremists on both sides. And I think what was meant by that is that the agreement is clear enough to generate certain expectations of both sides that, you know, there will be a near parity of the use of power, division of spoils, and so forth. But the agreement is not clear enough to decide how to work out the differences that arise when you don't get that, when one side is dissatisfied. And what that has led to is a long, difficult debates between both sides, which has been exhibited through the question of appointments most particularly. It's been 10 months since the government came into power, and we almost have a cabinet. We're still waiting, I think, for the confirmation of the Minister of Defense. But it's been, you know, a long time coming. There's been disputes about individuals. There have been disputes about how to resolve the disputes about individuals. And there's been disputes about what is or should be the process for deciding who should be appointed. And if, you know, one might simplify by saying, you know, President Ghani has tried to get a certain sort of level of competence. But he's also been hobbled by his own rule, self-imposed rule of not using anybody who's been a minister before. So it's been a very curious process of trying to get these teams appointed. There are only one-third of the governors appointed. There's still disputes over judicial appointments, over disappointments on the Electoral Reform Commission, and so forth. And so the question we were asking is, well, okay, you have these differences, you have entrenched positions, but what about, you know, the usual go-betweens? Aren't there people that are trusted by both sides who can sort of mediate between the two? And the answer I was given is, you know, those people who try to be go-betweens and who try to mediate end up being distrusted by both sides. They're distrusted by the side on whose behalf they're from, and they're distrusted on the side, you know, that they're trying to be reasonable with. So again, it's this phenomenon of encouraging extremism and entrenching distrust. And then finally, there's a sense that President Ghani might be trying to wait out Abdullah. The advantage that President Ghani has is his position is in the Constitution. Chief Executive Abdullah's position is not in the Constitution. So there's a sense that President Ghani is just going to try to make this go as long as possible until CEO Abdullah sort of withers away. But Abdullah's in a position where what he has is probably about as good as he will get. So, you know, he can't really relinquish that position. So that also adds to this dynamic of antagonism and obstructionism, which has, as Minister Jalali pointed out, undermined performance and governance at the expense of trying to achieve consensus and unity in what seems to be still, you know, a fairly poisonous environment. Now, so that's within the national unity government. What you have had emerging is outside the national unity government a kind of opposition. And this didn't really exist in the Karzai era. I think in the Karzai era, since he had huge resources at his hands, and unlike President Ghani, Karzai had unified power of appointments. So you had people who were in the government or people who were hoping to get in the government, but nobody who wanted to be in the opposition, really, because that was then you might put yourself out of contention. Now what's happened is President Karzai himself, as an ex-president, is sort of playing an opposition role. You might have seen the New York Times interview with him today where he says, you know, I'm kind of retired, I don't want to play a role. But they also list all of the people who are coming in and out of his office consulting with him. He has publicly broken with the National Unity Government over the issue of Pakistan that Mawid will discuss. He said, you know, I can't support it. And there are other characters as well who are now beginning to sort of gravitate either towards him or set up their own polls. And these are the ones where I mentioned before are somewhat opportunistically hoping that there might be a collapse of the government. And if there is a collapse of the government, they'll be the ones who will be there to sort of pick up the pieces. This is a widely rumored strategy in Kabul. I think it's an extremely dangerous strategy. Somebody we spoke to said that they told President Karzai, if this government collapses, it will not be you who picks up the pieces, it will be Taliban or Daesh. So, you know, don't play this game. But there is, everybody seems to think this game is being played and that there are attempts to try to make life as difficult as possible for the government in order to engineer a kind of collapse, which will lead to certain scenarios, which I'll go to in a moment. So this opposition is sort of kind of a new feature in Afghan politics, and it complicates the situation for Ghani in particular, I think. As I say, he's trying to play this game with Abdullah to marginalize him. At the same time, the political forces around him, to some extent, are getting larger and larger and more powerful, and it's very hard right now to read which way that's going to go. So, you know, given this situation, given this state of a sort of perpetual institutionalized crisis, what is the way out? It was anticipated that you would have this situation. And the September agreement that created this government also created a path out of it. And the path was to have electoral reform, then parliamentary elections and district elections, and then a lawyer jirga held according to the terms of the Constitution within 2 years. The problem with this way out, and I sort of was critical of it at the time, was it seemed to me that 2 years was far too short a period to allow all of these processes to take place. New voter registration, district council elections have never been held because district boundaries haven't been drawn. So what was going to happen was you were going to reach a point where either it would be clear that the all of these processes could not happen in time and you'd have to extend the timeline, or if you're Abdullah and you want to have a lawyer jirga as soon as possible to institutionalize your position, you would have to make some shortcuts. And neither of these options were going to be very good for the legitimacy of the government. I think we've arrived at that time. There was a 4 months ago, a electoral reform commission was appointed for the duration of 4 months, and there's still no agreement on what exactly the composition of that electoral reform commission is. So just on the reform issue, we're way beyond the timelines. So I think it's going to be very difficult to get out of this situation in the way that it was mapped out in the September agreement. In addition, some people say there's actually not really an incentive either for Abdullah or for Ghani to go for elections right now because of the diffusion of power that I mentioned. President Karzai and then some backers of Abdullah like Atta probably have more power now or could control an election more easily than either Ghani or Abdullah. So there's a built-in incentive maybe to slow walk the electoral process. Then you have the problem that Andrew mentioned initially, the parliament next week expires. There have not been elections. There will not be elections. So there's going to have to be a kind of a jerry-rigged solution to, you know, extending its term, but somewhat unconstitutionally. So this has led in Afghanistan to the discussion of other options. Emergency lawyer jirga, which doesn't really exist, but it would be a kind of representative body that would be cobbled together somehow. And some people also are sort of looking to the U.S. to come in and provide, you know, some kind of rescue like they did in September. But I don't think here there's a huge amount of appetite for that. So all of that contributes to an environment of a great deal of confusion, a great deal of a lack of confidence in the future, because people can sense the crisis. They can sense the government not being able to do what it should be doing by now, not meeting its reform promises that it had made. It can sense the press of security. It can sense the economic demands. And above all, there's sort of no way out, no clear indication of how it's going to get around this, which feeds again to the talk of collapse. I'll give you, to conclude, three things that I think we should do or not do to try to make at least improve the chances as much as possible of this situation not reaching a collapse. And again, a lot of people talk about collapse. A lot of people talk about the government muddling through. But I think the first thing is to avoid in any way encouraging any sort of move towards an interim arrangement that would go out of the bounds of the national unity government so far, as much as you know, this government is problematic. I do think that the one glimmer of hope, as Andrew pointed out, is when the appointments are out of the way and the main source of friction between the two teams is out of the way, there may be a chance that actual governance will start happening, and hopefully they'll be able to recoup the huge momentum they've lost over the last 10 months. So, which leads to the second point is, I think we, especially as Americans, members of the international community, need to support this national unity government, both on the military side and on the political side and on the financial side. We were meeting with a defense official, and it was sort of almost wistful when he said, you know, we need 25, what is it, ME-35 helicopters. And when you think of what the huge asks used to be and the huge offers from us used to be on the military side, he said, just for the next 3 months to survive, we need these 25 helicopters. It sort of gives you a sense of how little could actually go quite a long way right now. And the third thing is, I think we need to salvage as much as possible of this electoral reform agenda. But it needs to be a sane electoral reform and a realistic electoral reform. And the final point is, I think if any electoral reform project or discussion that is had within a domestic government situation, which is as toxic as it is right now, will only add to the toxicity. I think there really needs to be, first of all, a greater consensus within the national unity government before we can talk seriously about electoral reform. Otherwise, the reform process, which really is in the end going to be the only way that leads us out of this, even if it's not elections in 2 years, will just become subsumed by, again, the deep levels of mistrust that we sensed and that are contributing to a terrible security situation and maybe, Bill, a terrible economic situation.
Thank you, Scott. So we're going to really rely on Bill to bring us some good news here. But we're fortunate to have Bill here at USIP as a senior Afghanistan expert. Bill first started working in Afghanistan in the 1970s, so has a lot of history there, then had about a three-decade career with the World Bank, including as the World Bank official who went to Kabul in 2002 to reopen the World Bank office there and served as the country manager and has been working on Afghanistan more or less most of the time for the last decade as well. So anyway, over to you, Bill. And could I just say also, just again, what struck me again in Kabul was probably even more so than some of the political problems was the economic crisis. And I think partly because it doesn't get nearly as much attention because many of us did not do so well in our microeconomics and macroeconomic classes and don't pay as much attention to these things as the politics. But I think it's serious, and we're fortunate to have someone who actually knows what he's talking about on the economic front. So over to you, Bill.
Well, thank you, Andrew. I think that unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to bring a lot of good news, but luckily, still, I'm not the last panelist. And Muid shared with me some data that the Pakistan economy is not doing too badly. So there's some good news there.
That was official data, not mine.
So I'm going to first just give a little bit of background because I think it's too easy to forget what the Afghan economy actually is. I'll quickly go through some recent developments and how we got to the current crisis. Talk more about the current situation, and then if I'm lucky, I'll run out of time before I give some thoughts about what could be done. I think we just need to, at the beginning, I'll step back and remind ourselves of the basic features of the Afghan economy. It traditionally was a largely subsistence agriculture and livestock economy. There was a fair amount of trade, but almost absence of manufacturing and most modern services. And all along, virtually since the mid-18th century, Afghanistan has been dependent in different ways on external funds to balance the economy and to run the government. So that is sort of a continuing paradigm. Now, in the past nearly 40 years of a protracted conflict, on top of this base, a war economy has been grafted. And, you know, that includes a lot of international military spending, weapons, smuggling, opium, other illicit activities often geared toward financing war. Then, since 2006, clearly the international military expenditures and aid became the dominant factor in economic trends. And this induced very rapid economic growth among the fastest in the world at around 9% per year, but very highly import-intensive and service-oriented as opposed to agriculture or manufacturing, and basically unsustainable. In Afghanistan, what are the key, I think we also should keep ourselves mindful of what are the key constraints. And one of them is water and irrigated land or well-situated land, and it was already alluded to by Andrew at the beginning. And the other one I think you could say is human capital, because even before the war and during the war, the literacy rates and other human capital indicators remained low. So it's unlike a lot of other successful developing countries where they relied on an educated and trained and low-cost labor force to generate manufactured exports, et cetera. That model just doesn't work for Afghanistan. I did not mention as a constraint lack of money, because money is not the constraint. There's tons of private Afghan money floating around, some sunk into real estate, some of it elsewhere, a lot of it sitting in the neighboring countries, and that's one of the one of both the symptoms and also one of the sort of potential areas where attracting that money back might help. Well, since 2011, I'll make a plug for a peace brief, which I assume is hopefully is outside, just which outlines what happened in recent years. But it's not at all surprising when the drawdown occurred and international military expenditures declined sharply and military-related aid. But keep in mind, the civilian aid has not declined so closely, but it's this huge reduction in international military expenditures and associated demand in the economy that has caused a precipitous decline in economic growth. As I said, 9% per year on average earlier, well, 3.7% in 2013, about 2% in 2014, and 2015 looks about the same. Afghanistan's domestic revenue, where, by the way, until 2011, that was a success story. From probably 2 or 3% of GDP at the beginning of in 2001 and 2002, it went up to 11.6% of GDP, which is higher than Pakistan's rate at the time, and higher than Iran's non-oil revenue to GDP ratio. So, but coming back to the last, so, but then it's declined basically by 1 percentage point of GDP or more per year, very precipitously. Some of it is the slowdown in economic growth. Other appears to be burgeoning corruption related to the short time horizons in the recent transition. Little business investment, high unemployment, capital flight, increasing flight of people too. More asylum requests, I think, in toward the end of last year and this year. So. None of this is terribly surprising, a huge demand shock, but I would say perhaps even more important was the declining confidence and the compounding uncertainty, and I'll just give three or four factors behind that. I mean, the long delay in signing the BSA was, in my view, quite a destabilizer for the economy. The election imbroglio, it just went on and on. And so, and then when the outcome came, it didn't really settle the uncertainty because, as Scott had mentioned, there's sort of an institutionalized, continuing kind of political crisis. This is not an environment when any sensible private investor would want to invest. And I would argue also last summer's U.S. 2016 troop withdrawal announcement, particularly the timing of it in the middle of an election in Afghanistan, was also made people worried and certainly did not provide another a sign that businessmen should invest more. Deteriorating security and corruption I've already mentioned. So the current situation and prospects, I mean, basically looks like more of the same. Slow growth. Growth has not actually yet gone into negative territory, and I think the story behind that is agriculture has not done too badly. They've had several good harvests in a row. If they hadn't, or if in the future they have a poor harvest, the economy will go into decline. Right now, it's basically growing around the rate of population growth, which means no growth in per capita incomes. The fiscal crisis, I won't go into detail because I'm conscious of the time, but you can read about it. It's quite dire and no end in sight. I think Scott has already mentioned, but the point being these security, political, and economic developments can't be seen in isolation, and the perceived ineffectiveness and lack of performance of the National Unity Government, the security situation, all of these have effects on economic confidence, investment, and economic growth. There, you know, to give a couple of positive things, there actually has been some improvement in revenue in the first 4 months of this current fiscal year. Final fiscal data for the first 4 months has come in, and actually total revenue grew by about 7%. That's not terrible, but it's much below the program target for the revenue of growing 25% for the year. So it's a little better, modest improvement, but nothing that will actually in any way really ameliorate the fiscal crisis. And I should add, the fiscal crisis is, I mean, the fiscal gap is largely due to the cost of the security forces, which are among the highest in the world, somewhere close to 25 to 40% of GDP. And another thing that people sometimes forget, Afghanistan has something like $7 or $8 billion of foreign exchange reserves. Those don't belong to the government. They belong to the central bank. They're usable for managing the balance of payments. And that is a nice cushion, which many countries don't have. Am I out of time, or do I have to say something about that?
No, you have time for some instructive recommendations.
Okay. Well, the first recommendation is that there are no silver bullets. There are no easy solutions. I mean, the fundamental way to make improvements in the short run is more Afghan, and forget about the foreign investment and all that kind of pie-in-the-sky stuff, Afghan business sentiment, private sector confidence and investment to pick up. But basically that, in my view, requires that, I mean, businessmen will look at the political and security situation, and if the situation is more of the same on that, how can you expect people to start bringing their money back from Dubai or other places and investing in the economy? There's been some talk about it using a demand stimulus. Well, you know, Afghanistan had, during the surge, had one of the biggest demand stimuluses in the world, and it helped in the short run, but anything that could be considered even now would be much smaller. And don't forget, the economy, it would remain very import-intensive and so limited benefits for the domestic economy. And by the way, if you pump more money in the current environment, it might also translate into a good bit more, mostly, or to some extent, into more capital flight. Job programs, labor-intensive public works. You know, Afghans have seen these. They're quite cynical about them. They provide a short-term palliative, but again, not really much. And natural resources, that's seen as a silver bullet by some. Well, maybe if we get into the questions, it's unrealistic in the short run and I think almost any economist you ask when they talk about natural resource-based growth, it's a resource curse. And there are many, many examples of countries around the world in much better shape than Afghanistan whose economies did not benefit from exploiting natural resources. So what can be done? Here's the constructive part. Well, you can do some modest measures to increase revenues. Like, I mean, they got 7% increase, I think, just by stopping a few very blatant forms of corruption. And, you know, the situation is so bad that you can actually get some modest improvements. There were also some other recommendations specifically on sort of ameliorating a little bit the fiscal crisis at the margin. Donors should really look at their portfolios. You know, everybody says the Afghan money government can't spend money, but a lot of it is a donor problem. You could shift money on the donor side from slow spending projects to ones that make more of an economic impact in the short run. Agriculture clearly needs a long-term effort, and that's clearly the area where Afghanistan has some limited comparative advantage. Irrigation, I mean, it's virtually criminal in my view that over the last 12 or 14 years now, there has not been a major new irrigation project. I mean, that's the scarce resource, or one of the main scarce resources in Afghanistan. So let me leave it on this note that, you know, maybe not a general demands stimulus, but what economists would call expenditure switching policies to try to make the economy less import dependent. One of those is exchange rate depreciation, right? You know, be a little more aggressive about that. Risky, it's a pretty dollarized economy in many ways. And what it means, basically, exchange rate depreciation reduces the cost of labor and switches incentives from imports toward exports. It certainly is going to be needed, but how fast and how much benefit you'll get from that is a question. But the other way to switch it is to focus on some trade policies. You know, don't protect wheat. Everybody talks about wheat and how Afghanistan needs to produce wheat. Well, the markets nearby Afghanistan are hopeless for Afghans to export wheat, so forget about that. And in a good harvest year, they're 80 to 90% self-sufficient. So you could get a little more wheat, and that might be nice, and particularly to stabilize it so you don't have such variability in production, again, through irrigation investments. But where Afghanistan's potential lies is in labor-intensive, high-value agriculture cash crops, with a caveat other than opium. And so, protect, you know, apples from China, almonds from California, God knows what else. I mean, you know, do a little bit of agriculture protection. Chicken from Brazil, yeah. I mean, this may sound very radical, but the U.S. in the 19th century developed its manufacturing base but with high tariffs. East Asian countries had high protection of agriculture. And the U.S. and European countries protect agriculture enormously in various ways. So why a country that's much poorer, why should it just open its markets entirely to dumping of agricultural products by neighboring countries? I'm being trying to be a little bit out of the box here. And then it perhaps...
Spoken like a good former World Bank official, yes.
Slightly more palliative would be, let's go for some innovative export subsidies again. That's how many countries achieved export performance. So let's not rule it out due to WTO or various other things. You could call them export promotion grants so you don't get a subsidy issue. But, and I would just end with a cautionary remark. I don't think anything that I've said is going to trump the political and security developments, but I hope I ended on a slightly more positive note.
Thank you, Bill. Last but not least, Muid Yusuf. Muid's director at USIP for South Asia programs. We have a large program in Pakistan that he oversees. We're also supporting work on some track two work on Indo-Pac and other things. But we're fortunate. We had to twist Muid's arm to stay. He was going to climb on a plane. He's off to Pakistan in a few hours. Among other things, to finish up his next book on sort of nuclear strategy and tactics in South Asia. So anyway, thanks, Muid, for sticking around to deal with this very easy last topic of the Pakistan role in the peace process and Ghani's outreach to Pakistan. I should note that Scott and Muid are writing a paper on this, which should be out shortly, sort of analyzing this outreach and its prospects for success. So, Muid.
Thanks, Andrew. If you're depending on Pakistan for good news, we know we're clutching at straws, but let me give it a shot. But thanks for the opportunity. Thanks for not letting me climb on the plane. This is only half mine, the presentation, because I'm going to give you a preview of the paper that I and Scott have done. But I won't give him credit just yet for anything I'm going to say till you start bashing me. So let me just make 4 points. I'm going to talk about reconciliation and this whole debate about President Ghani reaching out to Pakistan and getting criticized and blamed for it in Afghanistan, as Andrew mentioned in his opening comments. To give a little bit of perspective on why he did what he did and where we think this is going to be different than what had happened before and whether it may or may not work. So the first point to make is that, at least in my view, his outreach to Pakistan makes perfect sense, perfect logical sense. Not based on any liking for Pakistan, any naivety, as his critics have blamed him, but quite frankly because he's simply out of options. At least I don't see what his alternative option was when he took power. But to try and get to Pakistan for two reasons. One, reconciliation was still actually more crucial than when President Karzai was trying this. The Afghan state is weaker, as we've heard. The Taliban were getting stronger. And if you had to get stability, you had to get the Taliban somehow to curtail their insurgency. Now, then the question, why Pakistan? Why not any other way of doing this? And the answer is fairly simple. I think for the past 12 or 13 years, President Karzai and the U.S. and others tried to convince Pakistan to change tack on its policy on Afghanistan, on the Taliban, on insurgency. Not only did it not work, but I think Pakistan ultimately proved that unless it felt that its own self-defined interests in Afghanistan were addressed, It had enough maneuvering space, not only to fend off President Karzai, which turned out to be fairly easy, but also tremendous U.S. pressure in terms of doing more, in terms of trying to change policy. I think where the U.S. and President Karzai underestimated was how beholden Pakistan is and how serious it is about holding on to its self-defined interests, right or wrong. Despite sort of the U.S. assistance, despite U.S. pressure, and quite honestly, despite a lot of U.S. missionary work, which involved pleading and saying, please change. None of that seemed to work. And so if you're President Ghani, I don't think he had another option but to try addressing, changing his paradigm rather than asking Pakistan to change theirs, at least first, and trying to address Pakistan's concerns. Second, I think one also needs to keep in mind that this is not about the Taliban. I think President Ghani has made clear over and over that this is a longer-term vision about integration in the South Asian economy, about in terms of the roundabout that he talks about, in terms of reducing money on the ANSF, the expenditure on the ANSF. All of that, rightly or wrongly, requires Pakistan. And so I think there people are being unfair when they see this as naivety. Second point, his outreach, I think, is fundamentally different, or we think, is fundamentally different than President Karzai's. The contradiction in President Karzai's outreach, as I've just sort of alluded, was that he was trying to get Pakistan on board, but asking Pakistan to change its paradigm without addressing what Pakistan felt were its concerns. Now, the objectivity of those concerns are not under debate. That's not the question, whether the Pakistani concerns were objectively correct or not. But fundamentally, there were four things that I think that drove Pakistan's policy in Afghanistan over the past 12 or 13 years. And I think Pakistan was entirely consistent on these four throughout, and entirely consistent in playing its spoiling role because of these four. Number one, India. And again, this is not about objectivity, right or wrong. The paranoia, obsession, concern, whatever you want to call it. Anything that India did in Afghanistan, Pakistan saw as a net negative and started getting worried about much more than IOU would think it should have. Second, by extension, it did not want a leader or a government in Kabul that it felt was sympathetic towards India over it and may leave it out of the room where Afghanistan's future was going to be decided. Third, it wanted to achieve these two goals without completely rupturing its relationship with the U.S. Only superpower assistance coming in, didn't want to be on the wrong side, so the U.S. and Pakistani interests diverged on the first two points, on India and on the government in Kabul. But still, Pakistan wanted to make sure that it remained part of the U.S. war on terror or whatever while it did this. And so the policy was a lot of tactical support, a lot of behind-the-scenes support, but strategically, the divergence remained between the two sides. And I think both tried way too hard to convince each other, to convince themselves, and to convince us that there was actually no divergence. I think the divergence was real and it existed throughout. And finally, Pakistan did not want any policy or any development to create a backlash within Pakistan or instability within Pakistan. And thus, it kept resisting the idea of going after the sanctuaries in Fatah and against the Quetta Shura, et cetera. Let me make one interesting point here. Throughout this 12 or 13-year period, the U.S. and others continued to argue to Pakistan that the reason you're getting backlash is that you are being selective in your approach against militants. You're going after some and supporting some. Until you go after all of them, you're going to have backlash. The Pakistani view was, actually, no. Our problem is we did too much at your behest after 9/11. Which created this space in Fatah for people to come back at us. And so the more the instability in Pakistan, the more the Pakistani strategists or the decision makers felt that we are going to be selective rather than not selective. So this was a clear sort of divergence between the U.S. and Pakistan on how to solve the problem. In any case, ultimately, Pakistan held on to these four, and because of these, continued to diverge with the U.S. and the Kabul government. President Ghani has essentially changed Afghanistan's paradigm, not asked Pakistan to change its paradigm first, but it's gone ahead. He's gone ahead and done his first by addressing all four of these concerns. And that is what is making him so unpopular in Afghanistan, given that Pakistan, for good reason, is seen as very, very negatively in Afghanistan, almost an enemy country, et cetera. On India, it's very clear that he's taken a very different line, suspended the arms deal. His trip to India was very clearly soft on Pakistan. He is, unlike President Karzai, completely in the lead on the negotiations with the Taliban, and rather than trying to circumvent Pakistan, is going to Pakistan and saying, okay, you are saying you want to be in the room, deliver for us. Third, I think in terms of, and this is crucial and I think not completely understood, his ask, as far as I understand, to Pakistan, originally when this conversation started, was not military action against the sanctuaries. It was not to go whole hog and take out the sanctuaries through military action. The ask was, you need to deliver the Taliban on the negotiating table, choose a strategy that works. And this for Pakistan was crucial because, as I said, for 12 to 13 years, it did not want to and did not go after these sanctuaries through use of force. And so it had now the option of talking, doing whatever it needed to do to bring them to the table. So I think this was fundamentally different than President Karzai. And here I would argue that this makes it the first time since 9/11 that we've now got a chance to really see whether Pakistan is sincere in terms of saying that it wants peace in Afghanistan and will help and whatever, or the skeptics are correct that it actually doesn't care and just will watch while Afghanistan falls apart. Till now, Pakistan was holding out, I would argue, because of its self-defined interests that it felt were not addressed. The third point I wanted to make is I am not surprised at how things have gone so far, even though everybody else seems to be surprised and thinks that the game is over. Number one, I did a book on insurgencies in South Asia last year, and just building off that, I can tell you that what the Taliban are doing now, which is basically surging, is classic insurgent behavior before you want to really see where the talks can go. And simultaneously, they're throwing out suggestions and listening to Pakistan and going to China and going to Norway and whatever and talking, whether with any agenda or not, but saying we are ready to talk, but also very clearly surging to push the unity government to the brink and be in a position of strength. Second, I think the splits within the Taliban, the pro-fight versus the pro-talk group, that also tells me that it's not too difficult to understand why there is a group that is constantly going after, while some may be thinking that there is a conversation to be had. Third, I'm also not surprised, to be honest, at how Pakistan has gone about this. Because Pakistan's first sort of attempt is to get the Taliban to talk without changing anything in its paradigm. So it doesn't want to go after the Taliban. It wants to convince them by talking to them to say, why don't you go and talk, making life difficult for some of them, but not really doing anything that will squeeze or put pressure on the Taliban to really think that this is the moment to negotiate. The final point I want to make is that what Pakistan is doing and the way it's set up right now is not going to work. And so despite the fact that I'm saying that President Ghani did what he should have done and was his only option, he is fighting against odds. And here, going forward, to give the constructive part as I end, I think this is the moment. The next 3 to 4 months will tell us whether Pakistan is willing to change its paradigm or not. It's clear that it tried to convince the Taliban within the paradigm that it had. It's tried to get them to talk. I think there is a change in Pakistan on that. I think there's more happening behind the scenes than we know, but none of it is working. It's very clear that the Taliban are surging, the spring offensive goes on, and they are pushing hard to see if they can get the unity government to collapse. And so whatever Pakistan has done so far is not working. And so there needs to be now a very concerted, we need to see a very concerted effort from Pakistan. But, you know, the irony of this whole discussion for all these years is that we never got to specifics. We never talked about what is it that Pakistan needs to do. You know, saying wipe out the sanctuaries, okay, but it wasn't a conversation. Specifically, I think the strategy that's going to work is exactly the strategy that has worked for Pakistan against the TTP, which is to break the pro-talks and pro-fight groups from within, which is to go after the pro-fight groups through intelligence and police operations. Apart from the Haqqani network, there are going to be no military operations because you're talking about cities like Quetta, Peshawar, et cetera. So it's law enforcement and intelligence operations, and it is everything that President Ghani has put in his letter to Pakistan, including arrests, prisoner exchanges, et cetera, et cetera. Ironically, or interestingly, all of what the letter says is what Pakistan and Afghanistan had already talked about and agreed to much before the letter came. So both sides know what needs to be done now. The question is, will we see Pakistan take that route or not? And I think the next 2 or 3 months will define that. Two other sort of recommendations or constructive points. One, every conversation that we have with the Taliban, whoever is having it, should be on a one-point agenda, which is, what is it going to take to bring ceasefire? What are the prerequisites? Because that's what's going to buy time for President Ghani, for Pakistan, for everybody else. So rather than having a conversation about the constitution, women's rights, and everything, which will come later, I think, the conversation is, what is it going to take? What are the prerequisites to get a ceasefire, or at least a limited ceasefire on the ground in Afghanistan? And right now, I feel there's too much going on in terms of these talks without any focus. And then, internally, I think President Ghani, one of the mistakes I think he made, quite frankly, is that he hyped this Pakistan outreach way too much without knowing whether it will deliver. If it was done much more quietly, it would have been a different ballgame. But now, still, I think he has to do a better job at PR and explaining internally on what he's doing and why he's doing, because he's really getting beaten up over there. And finally, any perception that the unity government will not last or the ANSF will collapse will only strengthen the hands of the pro-fight Taliban. So for the US, for everybody else, and I won't go into details because others have spoken about this, whatever it takes to convince people in Afghanistan that the unity government will last and will not fall, I think is absolutely crucial. Of course, Pakistan has a crucial role in that by trying to reduce the violence. Last sentence is that, to my mind, going back to my book on insurgencies and now pulling back from the situation, theoretically, the best chance of talks beginning will be after this summer, if the unity government and the ANSF prove that they have not collapsed. That's what's going to strengthen the hand of the pro-talk Taliban to say, we can't have outright victory. And that's probably where I think space will open up further for Pakistan to do what it needs to do. But if it is true that Pakistan is ultimately not willing to do it, it's just not going to do it, then I think nothing will work here. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Muid. I think we now have time for questions. We'll probably take two or three at a time and then come back to the panel. This is being webcast, so this is on the record. Please identify yourself, but also please try to keep your remarks and questions relatively short. We'll start with you, Mark.
Thanks, Andrew. I want to thank the panel. As you mentioned, we just put out this report on the Afghan local police.
It's a little closer, I think.
It's on. Mechanical. I'll speak louder. I think that it really does relate directly to Minister Jalali's comments about security, but also affects the political process. Because what's happened is that over recent years, and what this report shows, is that rather than increase security, funding the now 29,000 Afghan local police in about 29 of the 34 provinces, when the U.S. is no longer embedded to essentially control their performance, results in a significant number of them, and this estimates 2/3, not contributing to security, and in some ways also engaging in the kind of abuses that undermine government support. And so what you have then is, as you mentioned, fundamentally stabilization requires strengthening the ANSF both the ANP and the ANA at the same time that you carry out government reforms. And if what you're doing is undermining that process, which is what this essentially finds, you essentially are undermining your hopes for stabilization. So what we're sort of saying here is that you need to identify the bad ones, help President Ghani get rid of them, and that's going to mean not just simply stopping their funds, because you have to do something with those people, otherwise they join gangs or they join the Taliban. And then the good ones, to have a timeline for incorporating them into the ANSF, particularly the ANP.
I'm Colonel Anil Raman from the Indian Army. My question is for Yusuf. My question is that, like you very clearly brought out, that Pakistan has been, you know, very steadfast in maintaining its geopolitical aims in Afghanistan. Why at this stage, you know, when it's on the cusp of victory, would it seek to abandon all that for some sort of negotiated peace with Ghani? It's achieved whatever it's wanted in Afghanistan. Is it just going to do that for the, you know, for the sort of idyllic sort of state of peace?
John Rothenberg, both political and economic. A year ago, the Ministry of Finance said that 14% of revenues was being allocated to the MULSAM's cash grant program for martyrs and disabled. And unofficially, they said that this and other outsized programs would be addressed if Ashraf Ghani won. So my question is, what are the other outsized allocations, and is there any chance that any of these are going to be addressed soon?
Thank you. My name is Arnold Zeitlin. I covered Afghanistan for the Associated Press in its golden age in the early 70s. One question, China has been taking an unusual interest in Afghanistan lately. Do you think that, what impact, if any, would its interest have on Afghanistan's future? Also, does anyone really expect a Afghan future without the Taliban?
Back to the panel. Do you want to start with, I don't know, the ALP question, then Mouid, did you want to respond, and anyone else?
You know, with the ALP question, I think you put it in two contexts, two perspectives. First, in the Afghan cultural perspective. The other one in the context of the international intervention in Afghanistan in the past 13 years. In the context of Afghan culture, the local communities and tribes always helped the Afghan government in order to augment its security forces when there was a need. But that was only part of a system. The government did not create militias. The tribes created militias. They were responding to the tribal leaders, not to the government. They were paid by the tribal leaders. They were committed to the ethos and norms of the tribes, not to the government. When government created militias, they became mercenaries, and they were not committed to the ethos that the community or the public army, which you call it. That was good when that system was there, because these tribes and state are part of one system. That works when the system is intact. When the system breaks up, the tribes find their own ways to deal with whatever actually supports that. During the 13 years of war, the tribal system is disrupted. And people who came and emerged, they actually were empowered by the tribes, by the international community, by the war, by assistance from others. So the so-called warlords that you called, or pattern networks. That is different situation. And therefore, it works only in areas that tribal system is still intact. It works in Arghandab. You go to Arghandab today, the local police works very well. and it's peaceful. Go to Hawkres. A few years back, Hawkres was the most unstable area. But today, the local police in Hawkres are doing well. In Paktika in some areas, and also in Paktia in some areas. But not in the north, that system is not there. So who those who are hired as local police are loyal and committed to the warlords or the people who. That's one context. The other is context of the past 13 years. In the past 10 years, there was a kind of a contradiction between building state institutions, building democracy, and also fighting terrorism. You fight terrorism with these militias, created militias, and they depended, the international forces dependent on these warlords, militias, and they were not interested in building state institutions. So on the other hand, the investment was made in state institutions. That's why DDR didn't work well in Afghanistan, partly because of the weakness of the government, and partly because the international community used some of these militias in order to fight terrorists. So therefore, in Afghanistan today, you have to put it in these two contexts. It works some areas, it does not work in other areas. In the north, actually, it's a disaster. In some parts of the south, it was good, in some part, it was not good. In Farah, you say that. The militia was created by during the President Karzai era from Barakzais. They went and took their war on the rival tribes of Nurzais. That created the paved the way for the Taliban to come and fill the vacuum. So you have to put all these in this kind of a context.
Do you also want to comment, does Afghanistan have a future without the Taliban?
I think Afghanistan, we had these talks with the Taliban representatives in France and in Chantier and others. Afghanistan missed two opportunities to work with Taliban in the past. One was in Bonn, the other one is 2003 when I was Minister of Interior and they were coming and they were asking something which was reasonable. They wanted to be immune from persecution and also they wanted to act as a peaceful political party. But nobody agreed to that at that time. Now everybody wants that. But the situations have changed. You cannot go back to that situation. But they can get anything they want only if they go through the legal process of the Constitution of Afghanistan. If they go and want to change the Constitution, they should go and do that. But today it is very difficult. I think the most important thing today that, as Moed said, is to work for a ceasefire. After the ceasefire, you can talk seriously about other issues. Maybe you can work with the Taliban after the ceasefire and they negotiate. Afghans always talk to each other. Even today, locally, they talk to each other. But working with Taliban and creating that peace in Afghanistan is not going to come as a package. It will be incremental, starting with ceasefire. Maybe that.
Did you
want to
respond?
So on the question of why Pakistan would, the first thing I'd say is Pakistan has not achieved anything in Afghanistan in the past 13 years, except ensuring that others don't achieve what they wanted to achieve. That's the real achievement. The answer to your question depends on what you believe Pakistan wants. If you think it wants civil war in Afghanistan, then I think you're right. I would argue that that's not the case. And the reason of the spoiling throughout the 12 years was the four reasons that I just explained to you. So if those four are addressed, Pakistan, I think, should, will, may change tack. Now, two things on this. One, the TTP part, the Pakistani-Taliban part and the instability within Pakistan, it's a much different context than it was in 1990s and 2001. So I think Pakistan, that is Pakistan's number one sort of problem right now. Number two, I think civil war, Pakistan does not have the space, unlike the 90s, to support anymore. So if it can't support financially and materially a civil war in Afghanistan, where is it going to end up if the Taliban start rising again? So to my mind, Pakistan's best bet right now is a mixture which is pluralistic, where the Taliban are back in Afghanistan, in but not on top. I think that's ultimately the goal as far as I can tell. And the indication I'll give you, if Pakistan really wanted civil war and the Taliban to rise, Pakistan made a U-turn on one thing, which is very interesting. In 2011, USIP did a report with a Pakistani partner asking the Pakistani strategic elite, who were part of, you know, in the mix, and what do you want in Afghanistan? One of the biggest concerns that showed up was that the Americans are here under a larger design to change the regional balance. They're going to keep permanent bases. They will never go. In 2013 and 14, Pakistan consistently started saying, U.S., please stay, please stay, please stay, don't go. If it wanted the Taliban to win in civil war, it made no sense for Pakistan to want the U.S. to slow down. So I think ultimately it's been a very Machiavellian realpolitik game which has spoiled a lot. But this is the moment we'll find out whether it is a civil war or it actually wants what I think it wants.
Did anyone else want to respond, Bill, or
just on the budget and on the programs?
Yeah, it's very interesting. I think it was in 2012, or maybe at the end of 2012, Parliament unilaterally tripled the payments for martyrs and disabled, which is for families of people who've died, and servicemen, et cetera, and civilian casualties. And the interesting thing about that is there was the benefit before was low enough that only those people who really needed it applied, and there wasn't much scope for corruption. The increase in the benefit was large enough that more people applied, a lot more, and also it became as not surprisingly useful for the bureaucracy involved to be corrupt then, because it was a large enough amount that they could demand bribes, et cetera. So that doubled. In 2014, I think. So it's, now what do you do about it? You know, it's a pretty popular thing, right? It would be, you know, I mean, who wants to go on record for reducing payments to families of people who've died in incidents, et cetera? What the government has done is they've just gone very slow and stopped accepting applications. That's not a very good long-term approach. Other outsized programs, it's sort of hard for me to think of too many that are under the Afghan government's control. There may well be outsized donor programs, which we could talk about. But, you know, one is the intelligence, right? That's gone up to $200 million a year. None of that is internationally funded. There may be other forms on top of it, but the $200 million bill for the National Directorate of Security is domestically funded. That's gone up very sharply. On the other hand, Minister Jalali said that intelligence was one of the areas where the loss of international side. Salaries, you know, Afghan teachers make, last I checked, make a good bit more than Pakistani teachers. Are you going to really cut salaries? And what about the international reaction if you go slow in increasing the number of teachers, which is what is the biggest part of the salary bill? You can just imagine that, you know, the reaction about not educating girls, even if the teachers are unqualified or they don't go to the present at the schools or lots of issues like that. So other than some possible scope, if there's some kind of semi-ceasefire to reduce the ANSF costs, there's not a lot under the Afghan government's direct control. Then there's some big donor programs, and which may be in need of trimming or reallocating, which I mentioned.
Let's go back for another round of questions.
Sure.
Okay, we'll put China on hold. We'll get back to China and take some more questions, and meanwhile, give some thought to China. Back there, the young woman in the middle.
Hi, my name is Mina Oberdick. I'm from Public International Law and Policy Group. So I want to highlight a point made towards the beginning of this discussion by Mr. Jalali and Mr. Wilder, the point that the roots of ongoing conflict in Afghanistan lie at the local level, beginning with tribal or personal feuds over land, resources, etc. Yet I also want to highlight that the policy prescriptions for today have predominantly been on top-down stabilization efforts, such as democratization and broad economic reforms more generally. So my question is twofold. Firstly, what efforts have been made to address the local drivers of violence at the grassroots level? And secondly, what could be done to increase such local efforts?
Okay, actually right next to you.
Good morning. My name is Joseph Sobek, and I'm with the British Embassy. My question goes towards anybody on the panel who would like to answer. But in regards to women's rights in Afghanistan, it's been one of the major areas that there has been some progress made. With the U.S. exiting, what do you think might be some of the major threats that this progress might have to face? And will this influence U.S. Engagement in the future? Thank you.
Okay, and Marvin?
Marvin Weinbaum, Middle East Institute. Moeed, is it?
I know what's coming.
Yeah, okay. Moeed, could you phrase it a little differently from what you've had in saying that, in fact, Pakistan has a new paradigm, but the trouble is it still hasn't given up on its old paradigm. It's got a new paradigm in that it sees the Ashraf Ghani government now as one that is in their interest, that stability and perhaps prosperity in Afghanistan now is there in their interest, and that any notion here of any kind of chaos, and so therefore it's willing to make that investment here. But at the same time, if it adheres to Ghani's demands here for action against the Quetta-Shura and Haqqani, it would be giving up on its old paradigm, which is based on the fact that although it may be supporting the Kabul government, it has no real confidence, or it can't be confident that that government is going to survive. So therefore, it has to maintain what it has all along, and that is have to have an insurance policy, a hedging policy. And the trouble is that both of them together are contradictory, because the very thing that you are banking on in an improved Kabul government, you're preventing or undermining by not giving up on the insurgents.
Okay, one more from the front row, and then we'll go back to the audience.
I would do China. Okay.
My name is Tamanna Hila, and I came recently from Afghanistan. That's 1 year ago. My question is to Mr. Byrd about, I think I heard about the relation between the signing of bilateral security agreement on and its impact on economic situation in Afghanistan. If you could more elaborate on that. Thank you.
Okay, we'll go back to the panel, and we'll start with China, and Minister Jalali has offered to address that.
First of all, I think with the question that I said the roots of conflict is tribal. It is only, I was talking about that area in Shinwar districts, that actually that internal feud actually was caused some of these people or tribal leaders to affiliate themselves with ISAF or claim that they have affiliated with ISAF. With China, I think China is interested, there's no doubt about the stability in Afghanistan, particularly after the withdrawal of the international forces. In track two meetings in US, China, and on Afghanistan, China has showed interest to empower the national security forces in Afghanistan. However, no concrete actions were taken, although there were some suggestions on the table for them. But politically, also, China can use its influence in Pakistan, and the major investment is making now in Pakistan. Whether that can be used by China, or whether Pakistan will be, willing to that kind of, kind of cooperation with China in bringing stability to Afghanistan, I don't know. But it is, however, there is a possibility. China indicated that it's interested in regional stability in order to, implement its One Belt, One Road project, so that the kind of a Silk Road of China there. That's in the best interest of China. However, China is still very concern about security in Afghanistan. That's why it has opened its contract with the in a copper minefield for renegotiations, and it is it was mentioned several times to Chinese that why they do that. This can bring some kind of stability to Afghanistan, but I think one answer that I got from them was that the market value of that copper is going down. Therefore, the Chinese government should subsidize that company in order to make up for the losses. On the other hand, the kind of a contract that was signed with China actually make it very difficult for Afghanistan to change some part of it. And therefore, this is the economic part of it. They are interested to invest in Afghanistan, but provided the security comes first. But in the security, too, China can play a role through Pakistan and also through its effort to kind of facilitate the talks with the Taliban. But we have to wait and see. I have not seen much practical steps taken in that direction.
If I could just add, I've been involved in a U.S.-China dialogue on Afghanistan as well. And you know, it's been fascinating just over the last 2.5 years of that dialogue, which partly intended to try to get China to take more interest in the situation in Afghanistan. Just initially, there wasn't much interest in just how it's increased of late. But again, primarily driven not by economic interests, which are much talked about, but primarily by the ETAM and the situation in Western China, Eastern Turkmenistan independence movement or whatever. So I think that's what really has driven their concern. I think of late, though, also the situation in Pakistan and the talk of their major investments there, of $46 billion on the recent president visit to Pakistan. I actually have my own concerns. I mean, at one level, I don't think investing that level of resources on north-south corridors makes much sense unless it can link to east-west corridors, which I think is where there's more economic activity. But also, I'm worried in some ways that Chinese maybe are not learning from our mistakes in Afghanistan, that pumping lots of money into relatively insecure environments with weak institutions does not necessarily lead to security. And I think so that, but I think they have a feeling that we were driven by security interests in Afghanistan, and their solution is to be driven by economic interests in. By economic investments in Pakistan shall lead to jobs, and that will stabilize the situation. Whereas I think if they started with more of a political strategy, as I wish we had in Afghanistan, to use that level of resources to incentivize a peace process, for example, most importantly on the Indo-Pak side, that would do more to stabilize that region of Pakistan and Afghanistan, which I think would then ultimately lead to more returns on that investment. But we'll see how that plays out. Just a very good point on the top-down, bottom-up. I think we do lots of events at Afghanistan, and you're absolutely right. I think this session was focusing a bit more on the political, security, economic transitions from a top-down perspective. Please, we do come to many of other events that focus on a wide range. We're fortunate to have a lot of expertise here, only a fraction of it here today on the panel, but we have Bill Keith Amedi here, who many, many years working in Afghanistan on rule of law, civil society, women's rights, human rights-related issues. Casey Johnson, as I said, in from Kabul, running a lot of our bottom-up field-based programming. Barmak Pashwak, with decades of experience working with civil society groups in Afghanistan. Ambassador Steve Steiner in the back, who leads a lot of our work on women's rights issues in Afghanistan here in Washington and networking. So there's a lot of resources there. But I don't know, Scott, if you want to add something on that as well.
It's a huge question, the bottom-up, top-down question. Let me make two or three stabs at it. First of all, when you have, as I described, a president that has appointment powers that go down to district-level leaders, there's kind of a connecting line between the top-down and the bottom-up where it's hard sort of to separate what's top-down and what's bottom-up. A lot of the research that we've been doing has come to the conclusion that it was sort of, rapacious, corrupt government at every level, which has been a driver of conflict to some degree at every level, but certainly, at the local level. When because you have an official appointment, you can say, you know, this piece of land, which was a feud between our families for hundreds of years, is now mine because I get to sign the piece of paper. That generates a conflict. At the same time, you know, there are many, many layers of conflict in Afghanistan, and it goes from the top down. I'm not looking at you, Moeed, for any particular reason, but, you know, meddling neighbors, you know, massive influx of cash, for example, from, you know, well-meaning superpowers that nonetheless sort of distort the, you know, the economy, that sort of top-down. And all of it acts in ways in which it's very difficult for us, and even I think Afghans, to read what exactly is happening and at each local level, you know, what is going on. My general theory of the conflict of Afghanistan, if you have to have one, is that nobody agrees yet on what all the rules are for working these things out. And in different places there are different rules, and in different places there are different sources of power. And as Minister Jalali had said, there's been this attempt to try to create this institutionalization, rule of law, but at the same time it hasn't succeeded to erase the kind of anarchy of norms and rules. My final stab will just be an example of a project that we're doing right now in Afghanistan, recognizing that a lot of the conflict comes from land disputes. One of the problems is the process for registering land depends on having documents, I think, from before 1972 or something. So if you don't have those documents, then you can't prove this land was yours. In the meantime, you know, you might have been a refugee or displaced, lost the documents. There might have been four or five different warlords over the period of the conflict that have seized and lost and retaken or had the land retaken. So, you know, how do you resolve this? So we've been working with the land authority to try to figure out a way in which ownership of land can be reestablished on norms that are recognized, but that don't depend on having documentation from 40 years ago. So that's kind of a bit of a bottom-up approach, and it comes from bottom-up research, but it happens that President Ghani has liked this approach and now is chairing, you know, the commission that's sort of looking into how this can be worked out. I mean, maybe it's not a good thing that he's chairing this commission. As I said, he's sort of, you know, chairing every commission and reading every report, but it certainly, you know, shows that there is a recognition this is, you know, it's a serious problem, and addressing it may be one way of eliminating some source of conflict at the ground level. So thanks for bringing up that question, but it's far more complex than I can give justice to, but I hope I give a little bit of nuance to it.
Moeed, we're running out of time, so if you had any concluding remarks you wanted to make as well.
Yeah, it's never fun to be the only Pakistani on the team. Right.
It's like being the only economist.
Only economist, that's right. At least you can speak the jargon and get away with it. So, Marvin, I think we're going to steal your line without credit and put it in the paper. I think you're exactly right. The question here to answer is, can both be done? Can the contradiction be removed? You know, for the past 12, 13 years, we kept talking about Pakistan should go after these sanctuaries, wipe them out. And I always wondered why the conversation never got more serious about what it means. Because if the ask was go after them militarily, it was not going to happen. So that's why I mentioned, is there a space for breaking up the pro-fight and the pro-talk? Breaking up the people from within the Taliban who are not listening to the pro-talk within the leadership, so that Pakistan is not giving up on that insurance completely, and at the same time going after the people who even the pro-talk Taliban would want to sideline so that there could be a real conversation. Now, I am not privy to any details on how far, you know, this is true or can happen, but to me, there is an opportunity, law enforcement, intelligence operations, selected arrests, families being put in some kind of trouble, of the people who are holding out this talk agenda. Because it's clear that there are certain who are talking, who want to talk. So I think that's the space, if it can be exploited, where you go after a part of them without going after the movement. I think that's probably the space that Pakistan is going to exploit, and we'll find out, to my mind, towards the end of the fighting season, not right now. In terms of just one or two other sort of comments. One, how does this work? To me, at the end of the day, Pakistan won't be able to have it both ways. It can't argue that it's relevant and that it doesn't have leverage.
And so the question is, if it has enough leverage to push them to the table, when are we going to see it? If it doesn't, then it's irrelevant. And I think the next few months will tell us. But never before, I think, has Pakistan been in a position, or the situation has been such that Pakistan simply can't make an excuse not to do more, because its concerns, I feel, have been addressed in a way that they've never been before. And so this is going to be the real test, ultimately. President Ghani, though, has to do more internally to make sure that the political backlash he's facing through PR, through other mechanisms, but also probably through becoming sterner on Pakistan in public, at least. And he's started to do that, because otherwise he's going to keep getting this blame from everybody. And finally, quite honestly, I think we here and everybody else who's discussing this needs to understand the complexities and the nuances and the problems in going from here to a ceasefire. I mean, I feel people are now more impatient than President Ghani is. Everybody wakes up and says, oh, two more attacks, nothing is moving. Even if you play out how the ceasefire will come about, this is going to take talks after talks after talks, because the Taliban will want something in return of giving up, in return for giving up their prize sort of commodity, which is violence. Let me stop there.
I saw a tweet from Barney Rubin today saying, pessimism on peace and optimism on war make you a wise man in D.C. I think there is lots of grounds for skepticism. I do think that this is an important time where there's a risk of being so skeptical that maybe indeed something does change, but we're too skeptical to take advantage of it. But Bill, did you want to respond?
There was one question directly, and then there was a question about women's rights and the threat to them, and I don't know which of us can do it, but I could say something about it.
Briefly, because we're running out of time.
Okay, yeah. On the BSA, I mean, I think it's just another example, one of several salient examples of gross irresponsibility in managing Afghanistan, both by, in this case, Afghans, President Karzai, and in other cases by the international community. I mean, it's just self-inflicted wounds. In 2013, signing the BSA after that advisory Lloyd Jirga endorsed it, you know, contrary to some expectations, would have been an easy thing to do. The point is, in 2014, all these sources of instability are concentrated together: the international drawdown, the elections, the economy clearly getting into bad shape. Why not find an easy source of stability, the BSA? And so it gets to my general point about the expectations and confidence for the economy reflecting on some of these political actions. And it's just such an obvious no-brainer. Then signing it later after didn't have the same impact, because it was through after a long election process, which certainly worsened the economic prospects and outlook, and with so many uncertainties about the national unity government. Of course, it was good that it was signed in the end, but signing it did not have the same impact as earlier. I think the topic on women's rights is a big issue. You know, it's hard to say much on it quickly. It's a challenge. I mean, one way of putting it is clearly women's participation in development is really critical for Afghanistan's future. That's essential in the short run. I mean, what will some of the Taliban demands be related to? So far, they're talking a much better line than they talked in the 1990s, but we don't know if it comes down to it. And I think there's both a risk of backlash within Afghanistan, and then a second risk is possibly that the international community doesn't give any space for Afghans themselves, men and women, to discuss it and takes sort of knee-jerk reactions. So I think I'll leave it at that. There are others much better qualified than me to talk about it.
Scott. Yeah, I mean, maybe pick up on that point. I didn't talk about the outside the sort of governing arrangements of armed opposition, the Taliban and so forth, and the possibility of a negotiation, which will complicate and has been built into certain scenarios about eventual Lloyd Jirgas and so forth. But, you know, picking up on the question of women's rights, I think it's clear that there have been certain formal rights, especially that have been granted, and that to a certain extent have been taken advantage of and well used. And there are also traditional practices that continue and lots of discrimination that happens at the level of society. The question I think that is going to be very interesting is if we do get to this negotiating position and the Constitution is reopened, will these formal rights still, the quota for women in the parliament and so forth, will they still remain in the Constitution, or will they be negotiated away for the sake of some kind of peace? And most interestingly to me, will we care at the level of the international community as we get to that point and as we continue our withdrawal? And I'm not so confident that question is easy to answer in the affirmative right now.
Final brief point. Okay, a few points. First, there's no alternative to the Afghanistan National Unity Government, I think. It needs to be supported. How? I think the Afghan can help, and also the international community can help. As for the term in the area of security, I think there is a need for integration of security institutions through reforms in Afghanistan. That reform is very needed. However, Afghanistan is now facing immediate challenges. The leaders do not have the luxury to think midterm or long term. They are dealing with immediate actions. One cannot expect that much change will take place in the near future. I think if by this fall the security forces, they do not have to defeat the Taliban, if they hold their own and not lose, I think then the government will have a story to tell. And in order to do that, I think it needs international support in areas that I mentioned, particularly in the area of training, of leadership in mid-level, Afghan army and police offices, and also in the terms of material support in the intelligence, logistics, and air power. Currently, the resolute support is fragmented. The U.S. forces, the troops that are in Afghanistan, they can support only the ministries of interior defense in the core in Kandahar, and not even in Helmand, Kandahar and Nangarhar province. The core of Paktia province, the core in Helmand, they do not have the capacity or the resources to support. The Herat core as a service was supported by Italians, in the North core by Germans. So there is a fragmentation of resources, and it's uneven. I think this needs to be addressed if the Afghan national security forces should be able to respond to these immediate challenges. And on the other hand, Afghan national security forces should adopt to the new environment, battlefield environment. She should come out of the garrison mentality and take the war to the insurgents, and through agile and kind of effective raids to disrupt concentration of the Taliban.
Thank you. Minister Jalali made several of my points. I just wanted to say that USIP works in many conflict zones around the world. And call me naive, but I would still take Afghanistan as the potential for a relative success story. And I think I'm much happier about the prospects for peace in Afghanistan than I think some of my colleagues who are currently trying to work on Iraq and Syria and Yemen and Libya and many other crises. But I think one of the issues we wanted to emphasize today, though, that the situation is at a critical juncture, and I think every year we say this is the critical year in Afghanistan, and now we're saying it again. In fact, we're saying the next several months are the critical several months. Precisely, I think, from what Minister Jolly said, is if the government can get through this fighting season and show that it actually the ANSF can stand up and survive, without the degree of international support they had in the past. And again, I think that's a victory. I think there's a lot of responsibility for the national unity government leadership to make this work. I think it's taken too long for them to actually get their act together. But it's, again, just really in the last couple weeks, once these appointments were made, I think that there is a time of hope that this incredibly contentious issue of appointments, if they can get through that, and actually then start governing and be perceived to be governing and doing things, I think that they can regain some of the lost ground. Because absolutely the message I think we wanted to come back convey also is there is no plan B. As our board chairman always says, plan B is to make plan A work. And I think we really do need to focus on that and discourage talk about other possibilities. I really don't think that there are any realistic ones. But I do think the next few months are critical. I do think that there are some tangible things that can be done. I think we've talked about it. I mean, I think the issue of, support, additional support for enablers, I think when the Afghan National Security Advisor is talking, we need 25 or 30 helicopters. I mean, I think that's, those are the kind of issues that are viewed as critical in terms of, as well as the ISR support. I also do think this economic piece is critical. Is there something that can be done to help? I know Bill probably is not in favor of this with his former World Bank cut, but some kind of stimulus to buy a little political space to help the government during the next few months as well. And also very critically, how do we counter the abandonment narrative and the perceptions that the international community in general and that the U.S. is, in particular, are pulling out, according to, in my personal view, a somewhat artificial timeline. I think we should be trying to remain engaged, certainly not at the levels of the past, but we, in terms of, in a way that keeps, greatly enhances the prospects for stability in Afghanistan. Because I think if we fail that, I think it's going to be a disaster for U.S. national interests in the region. In particular, I think the impact it's going to have on Pakistan. But also, first and foremost, for Afghans. I mean, the biggest losers, if we go back to war, will be women and children, and then the Afghan population in general, but also the region. And I do think I'm still in the camp that there is, Afghanistan could be a foreign policy success story for the U.S. if we remain engaged. So with that personal view note at the end, and then hopefully a little degree of optimism, we'll conclude. I'd like to thank you all for coming, and also thank our panelists. So. Thank you.